think I was down. Spirit breakdown. Heaven come down.
Lift up your voice and say now. You have won it all for me. I strive. We are healed. Eyes now pierced, hands we're free. Eyes blood, we're washed clean. And now we have the victory. And the power of sin is broken. Yes, he did. He has won. Yes, he has. It all. So every voice, we sing hallelujah. On the victory. I'm so glad that he's alive. Sing. You have won it all. Say your death could not hold you. Nothing could hold you down. No, God.
You are the risen King.
And you're seated. Stretch out your hands, stretch out your hands, stretch them out. He's alive now. He's alive now. Said he's alive now. Said he's alive now. He's not dead. So grateful that he lives. Oh. Come on, it just says, come on.
Stand, and I Broadcast. Amen. Everything's going our way in the Lord. That's our mantra for 2020. Everything's going our way in the Lord because we're going in the way of the Lord. We're advancing, people of God. We are moving forward. We are advancing on the enemy's turf, and we are making progress. We really are. We are advancing. Because storms will come, but storms don't last always. So we have to realize, we have to understand that, we have to keep that before us, that storms don't last always. And we're going to come out victoriously, victoriously. Everything's going our way in the Lord. Amen. So the Christian House of Prayer family and the Covenant Connection International family and our partners all around the world, all over the world. We have partners and members, there's people joining the church on streaming, joining the church on streaming. We thank God for our covenant partners and those of you that will be joining this ministry and those of you that will be birthed into the kingdom today. This is the day that the Lord has made. And I say it every day when I get up. This is the day that the Lord has made, and I can't help it but to rejoice and be glad in it. We're on this side of heaven, and we're among the living today. So that means God has something for us to do. Amen. If all we can do today is just lift up our hands in the sanctuary and praise Him. Hallelujah. Let's stand to our feet. Let's just stomp on the devil. Stomp on the devil and give God the praise. Let's lift your hands up and praise Him for what He has done throughout this week. Amen. Amen. Before we get started, and you may have your seats in the presence of our life-changing King. Starting next week on the bereavements, we'll have them posted during the announcements. But today I want to give our condolences to one of our staff members, Minister Daniel Dykes, a minister in his own right. He helps clean the church. He helps maintenance. You know, we all are ministers. And so he has ministered and labored among us. And so we want to send out to his family all over, wherever you are. We give our condolences in the passing of Daniel Dykes and the rest of the family, Mother Louise Dykes. This woman of Zion has gone on to be with the Lord. And then we have one of our Deaconess Renee Butler, her mother, Henrietta Victoria Ellis. She's going on to be with the Lord. And then one of our faithful members, her name is Helen, but she told me yesterday, she said, call me Hal. Like they call you Val, call me Hal. So her name is Hal Bates, and her mother has gone on to be with the Lord. Josephina Pascua, if I mispronounced that, please forgive me. And then this morning, Evelyn, E-V-E-L-I-N-E, Christian Blue, her father, Oliver Blue, went on to be with the Lord. And I'll tell you, each person, I haven't talked to Sister Blue yet, but each person that I've talked to, you have heard their faith. Their faith has kept them, and they are encouraged, and they know that absent from the body, we are present with the Lord. But we know that when someone passes on, a mother, a father, a brother, sister, whoever that we love, we know that even our souls still hurt. And we still are touched in that way. So we want you to know that you stood with us and we are standing with you during this time. You will never get over it. You'll never get over this family member, but you will get through it. And you'll be able to lift up holy hands and smile and laugh in the remembrance of your loved ones. God bless you. Now this morning, we're celebrating this weekend Memorial Day. And these are the military, all the armed forces that have served for our liberties. So this morning, I would like to have Dr. Gregory Krull. He's going to pray for us this morning. He's a veteran in the ministry. He's a veteran in the military. And I would like him to come up, and we're going to pray. We're going to pray for those that have stood in harm's way for us, and also for this weekend, safety for this weekend. And after that, we're going to have praise and worship. And immediately after that, I'll be back with a word from the Lord. God bless you, man of God.
Let's join our hearts together in prayer. Eternal God, our Father, we are so very grateful for your great grace and your mercy that you have extended to the land of the free and the home of the brave, these United States, America. This is Memorial Day weekend, and Father, we will always remember and we will never forget the men and women of our armed forces, the Army, the Air Force, the Coast Guard, the Marines, every branch of our Department of Defense, every civilian contractor that have been involved in ensuring that we as American citizens will continue to have the liberty and freedom to do what we're doing now, which is to worship you. And so, Father, your word reminds us that blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord. These men and women from generations gone into eternity, some have fought and died. Some are still fighting on the front lines even today. And so, Father, we ask that the canopy of your protection will continue to be about those that are, Lord, deployed in foreign places or in many different places around the world. Keep them safe, we pray in Jesus' name. We pray for their families, Lord, as they too understand that the sacrifice that their husbands and fathers are making is so that we can continue to be free. And so, Father, this Memorial Day weekend, we remember and we will never forget. And we thank you for these men and women that have fought and died, that we might continue to do what we're going to do here today. And that's to praise and worship your holy name. And so, Father, with all of our hearts, we remember and we will never forget, Lord, from generation to generation, the sacrifices that have been made and the sacrifices that will continue to be made, that we might continue to be the land of the free and the home of the brave, these United States of America. This is our prayer, O Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen and amen.
Hallelujah. We want to just clap our hands this morning. We want to give God glory and praise that is due his name. We worship you, O God. Magnify the Lord with me and let us exalt his name together. Hallelujah. We come to celebrate the King because he's glorious, he's righteous, he's our master of everything. Let's celebrate our King. He's the ruler of everything. Let's lift his name on high. Come on, Zion, we praise our King. Celebrate our King.
Celebrate our
He's the ruler of everything.
He's the ruler of everything.
Let's lift his name on
Let's
high.
Lift him up.
Come on, Zion, we praise our King. Come on and clap your hands.
Our King.
My hallelujah belongs to you. can you just raise that up and say, my hallelujah,
my hallelujah belongs
thank you.
To you.
It's the highest praise that you can give to God.
My hallelujah belongs to you.
Oh, 'cause my hallelujah belongs
my hallelujah
and only you,
belongs
God.
To
thank you, Jesus. You deserve.
You deserve.
What does he deserve? He deserves
deserve
all.
You, Lord, we bow in the presence of our King, yes.
Oh,
Hallelujah. Don't clap. Don't clap your hands. This is an intimate moment with your Father. And just love on him. Just begin to tell him how much you love him, how much you adore him because of who he is and not just for what he does for us. Hallelujah. But if we just magnify his name and glorify him and continue to have his name, Jesus, in our mouths, he will continue to do what he do for us and in us and through us. Because God, you deserve the glory. Get the glory out of our lives. Hallelujah. We bless your name, Jesus.
The Christian House of Prayer has made it easy and safe for you to give your tithes, offerings, and gifts of love. Give online at CHOP.org or the CHOP app and look for the Giving tab. Give in person at the church lobby on Wednesdays from 6 p.m. to 8 p.m. or on Sundays from 8 a.m. to 10 a.m. We've also made it convenient for you to give at the Covenant Savings Federal Credit Union Night Depository Box 7 days a week, 24 hours a day. You can also give by mail at P.O. Box 960, Coppers Cove, Texas 76522. Let's continue to be faithful to God, and He will continue to be faithful to us.
Thirteen folds. Each fold a reminder of a life spent in service. Service to country, service to people, protecting God-given rights, preserving freedoms. 13 folds. At each fold, we remember the friends and family left behind, the mothers and fathers, sisters and brothers, sons and daughters left to pick up the pieces. 13 folds. And we remember the scriptures. Greater love has no one than this, that someone lay down his life for his friends. Each one loved greatly. We also remember that blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. And today we pray, God be near those who need comfort. So, draw close to those who mourn. Make your presence and appreciation known. Let this church be a safe place, a comforting place. And let us honor those who have given their lives in service to this country. 13 folds to signify a life given to service. Amen.
Praise the Lord. Wasn't that beautiful? That was beautiful. Thank God. Thank God. Well, welcome back. What a friend we have in Jesus. What a friend we have in Jesus. He's our mentor. He's our model. He's our motivator. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. And blessed is the man that trusts in him. We have to always start off our day, start off our lessons, start off our devotion with acknowledging that it's all about him. Jesus is our center, our circumference, our base, our boundary, the beauty, the balance, and the beauty, the sum and the substance of what our lives are all about. It's all about Jesus. It's all about him. He deserves a standing ovation and a praise unto him, because there's no one like him. There's no one like him. There's none to be compared to him. There's no one that we bow down to. Hallelujah. I want you to open up your Bibles with me to the book of John, chapter 14. And we'll be reading verses 16 and 17. And we are in a series entitled, We Need the Axe Head Anointing. And this is our third deposit. And today we want to talk about help wanted. Not help wanted as an announcement or an acknowledgement of help wanted, but as a question. Help wanted? And the only thing that we can say is, yes, I want it. Help wanted? And all we can say is, yes, I want it. I want it. I want the help. I want the help. Help wanted? Yes, I want it. John chapter 14, verse 16 and 17 reads, And I will pray the Father, this is Jesus speaking, and I will pray the Father that he shall give you another comforter that he may abide with you forever. Even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him, but ye know him. For he dwelleth with you and in you. Let us recite that together. And I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another comforter, that he may abide with you forever. Whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him, but you know him, for he dwells with you and shall be in you. Amen. May the Lord add a blessing to the hearers, the readers, and the doers of his word, and let all God's people say amen, amen. And amen. You may have your seat in the presence of our life-changing King. The axe head anointing is the working power and ability and influence of the Holy Spirit in the believer's life. Let me repeat that again. The axe head anointing is the working power, the ability, and influence of the Holy Spirit or the Holy Ghost, whichever way you want to say it, Holy Spirit or Holy Ghost in the life of the believer. The believer, the believing believer, not the unbelieving believers, but the believers that believe, the Holy Spirit will have a working power, ability, and influence of the Holy Spirit in the believer's life. And so the axe head anointing represents the yoke-destroying, burden-removing power of God. John 14:16, we just read, it says, and I will pray, this is Jesus saying, I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another comforter, that he may abide with you forever. Now here Jesus is conferring with his disciples, and he is introducing to his disciples the Godhead, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Ghost. He's bringing in another the last part, the Godhead, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Ghost to his disciples. In 1 John chapter 5, verse 7, it says, "For there are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Word," which we know the Word is Jesus. "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was God." Jesus is the Word. "And the Holy Ghost, and these are one." These are one. Now, John 14:16, when it says that I will pray unto the Father, and he will give me another comforter. I want you to underline that. Another comforter. Another comforter. The word comforter is parakletos. It means a counselor, not just a comforter, but a counselor, a teacher, a protector, helper, an advocate, another comforter. Another comforter, one who consoles. One that this, now, when he says, "I will give you another comforter," that word "another" is alos, A-L-L-O-S, alos, another, 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 alos, parakletos, another comforter. Now, that's profound, because when you look at that, when Jesus said another comforter, this means that the Holy Spirit was taking the place of Jesus. But he was not taking Jesus' place. It's just like if you're in a hospital and you have shifts, and nurses and doctors, they have shifts. They might have an 8-hour shift. Some of them work 12, 14-hour shifts. So the same, there's a nurse there taking the temperature, taking your blood pressure, making sure that you get everything you need, confirming back to the doctors, And ordering the medicines and so forth. And when that nurse shift is over, another nurse comes in to do what the previous one did. It's taking the person's place, but the person will come back the next day. And Jesus will come back. He said, "I don't know the hour and I don't know the time." He said, "I don't know, but the Father, he's the only one that knows the time that he's going to come back." So the Holy Spirit in the earth realm is just not someone that make you get goosebumps. He's not just someone that we think, "Oh, I felt the Holy Ghost." No, when we say, "Help Jesus," the Holy Ghost, he moves out. He moves out. To the name of Jesus, he moves out. When we say, "Help, Lord," he knows that that's him. That's his part. That's his part that he played. He is our witness. He witnessed to us. He brings witness to our mind. He brings witness to our soul that this is right. I know just this morning when I was in the bed getting up, and I'm kind of quiet in the morning. I don't do a lot of praying and moving around in the morning on Saturdays. I don't. I'm listening for the leading of the Holy Spirit. I'm listening for something that he might want to tell me. I'm listening. And sometimes, instead of what I believe that he should be telling me about, what, you know, the what I'm going to be ministering this morning, sometimes in my mind, there will come in my mind some things that you don't want to think about. And you say, "Why am I thinking about that? Why am I thinking about something like that at a time like this?" And the Holy Spirit, you say, "Help God. Father, help my mind. Help me to be able to keep my mind on you." He comes in. He said, "You want my help?" "Yes, I need your help. I need your help to keep my mind sanctified. I need you to keep my mind stayed on you." Amen. And so when we talk about the Holy Spirit, and when Jesus said another comforter, see, the Holy Spirit is in equal quality as Jesus himself. He's the third head of the Godhead, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Ghost, equal quality, but different functions. Equal quality. So when we think about the Holy Spirit, what my endeavor is to minister this message, the axe head anointing, is for us to consider the working power and the ability and the influence of the Holy Spirit in our lives. See, if we didn't have the Holy Spirit right now, we would all be going, all of us would be confused, totally confused, baffled, don't know what to do. But see, when we understand that the Holy Spirit is just not the goosebumps, he sometimes comes in a small, quiet voice. Sometimes he's boisterous. Sometimes he's not. You know, sometimes we think of the Holy Ghost as a feeling or an atmosphere, something in the atmosphere. This is when we know the Holy Spirit is there. No, the Holy Spirit is here. He lives within us. And sometimes he comes in like a mighty wind. He comes in and he just zoom, zoom, zoom. And sometimes he comes in and he says, settle down. Settle down. Because I got something to talk to you about. And I want you to listen. Listen to what I have to say. The praise and worship leader today, she said, don't clap. She said, let's just praise him. See, she was listening to the leading of the Holy Spirit. There's a time to clap and there's a time to just listen. There's a time to bow down. There's a time for everything. And he will let us know when the time is and when the time is not. Amen. And so Matthew chapter 28:19 says, therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Ghost, and in the Holy Ghost. I'm just bringing this out because the Holy Spirit is a part of the Godhead. Another comforter, Alos Parakletos. Can you say that? Alos or Alos, Alos, however you want to say it. I say it, Alos Parakletos. Say it. Alos Parakletos, another comforter, another helper, another witness, another teacher, another advocate. It's just like an attorney. When an attorney is representing an individual, he's representing the Godhead. If an attorney get up and start to make up stuff on its own, yeah, she did it. She, you know, you already told your attorney, I didn't do it. I didn't do it. And they get, nope, I know she said she didn't do it, but I believe she did it. He did it. The first thing you will say, Your Honor, I want another attorney. I want another attorney because this person is not representing me properly. Amen. So the Holy Spirit never talks of himself. You never say, we worship you, Holy Spirit. You never say that. You say, we thank you, Father, for the Holy Spirit. Father, we thank you that you have given us the Holy Spirit. When I came this morning, I said, I thank you, Father, for the Holy Spirit's presence in my life. I thank you, Father, that you will allow the Holy Spirit to do his office work as I give him his office space. Amen. The Holy Spirit, as I speak out of my mouth, the Holy Spirit is speaking to your heart. The Holy Spirit is speaking to your heart because only the Holy Spirit can teach you the things of God. Only the Holy Spirit can do it. And so as I give you the Logos, the Holy Spirit will give you the Rhema. Amen. That might be something that you're going through right now. And everybody in here got different situations. And so we're listening. We're listening for the voice of the Holy Spirit to speak. And he is God. He's part of the Godhead. So he could talk to the Carters. He could talk to everybody in here individually. And I'm giving one message. And he could talk to everybody in here about your situation. Because he is Alos Parakletos. He has all the goods. He has everything that it takes to get the job done. Amen? Everything that it takes. And so the axe head anointing is the Holy Spirit cutting in and then cutting out and causing and helping us to be able to bring forth results in our lives. Results. Results. You know, I'm one of them kind of Christians that I want to see results. Don't you? I want to see results. You know, I'm a child of God. You're a child of God. And we got to believe and know that there, with being a child of God, there should be results. If the Holy Spirit is leading us and guiding us in the way that the Word is saying that it should and it is, then there should be results. If your mind is all messed up and you get in the Word of God and you take the Word and you apply it to your life, then your mind should get straightened out. If your heart is broken and you don't know what to do, your heart is broken, you don't know what to do. The Word says that it can mend the brokenhearted. Jesus came to heal the brokenhearted, to mend it. Amen. And if we believe it and receive, I'm talking about believing believers, not unbelieving believers. Believing believers, then there should be some results as a result of us being a child of the King. Amen. There should be some results. And I you know, for me, I expect things to happen. I expect the Word to do what it says that it can do. So when Jesus said, I'm going to send you another comforter, he said, I'm going to pray to the Father. See, the Father is the Godhead. He's the one, he's the boss. God is the boss. But Jesus said, I'm going to pray to the Father and ask him to send the Alos Parakletos. Now, if the Father could have said, no, I ain't sending them. I'm not sending them. But the Father honored the request of his son, Jesus. And he sent us the Parakletos in our Holy Spirit. Amen. Now, I want you to turn with me to Luke chapter 10. And I want to talk about the spirit of Martha and the spirit of Mary. The spirit of Martha and the spirit of Mary. Because right now where we are, there's two groups of people that we're dealing with in the kingdom of God. One has a spirit of Mary, and one has a spirit of Martha. And we have to choose which side do you want to be on? You want to be on the, because Martha represents cares, the cares of the world, the cares of what's going on. And Mary represents contentment. Martha, care. Mary, contentment. Luke chapter 10. Now it came to pass, as they went, that he entered into a certain village, and a certain woman named Martha received him into her house. And she had a sister called Mary, which also sat at Jesus' feet and heard his word. But Martha was cumbered about, much serving, and came to him and said, Lord, dost thou not care that my sister hath left me to serve alone? Bid her therefore that she help me. And Jesus answered and said unto her, Martha, Martha, thou art careful and troubled about many things. But one thing is needful, and Mary has chosen that good part, which shall not be taken away from her. Amen. So here we have Jesus. He's entering into Martha's house. She has a sister by the name of Mary. And Martha, in verse 40, it says, but Martha was cumbered about much serving. And I can see her now, you know. I mean, you know, Jesus is like, I mean, having the highest office, having the president come to your house, having your senator in your area, having the Pope, or having Pastor Val come to your house. Y'all ain't gonna put me on that level, but God does. But come to your house. And you're and you're what should I serve? You know, is the house clean enough? Is the food, what does he like? What does Jesus like? I heard he liked fish. I heard he liked bread. I heard he liked, you know. And so Martha is there, and so Mary's there. And you'll see, as you say, it says, and it said she also sat at his feet. So that meant that Mary was helping Martha too. At first, Mary and Martha was getting the food together. And so Martha's getting the food, and she's serving everything, and she's running about, and I used to be like that. I used to be like that. I used to be so uptight about, you know, is this right? Is that right? You know, one time when I really realized that I had a problem, I was trying to fix something on the coffee table and it wasn't just right. And I went, no. And I was going back and forth like this. No, it's supposed to be over here. I said, you have lost your mind. You have lost your mind. And so we can get so encumbered, so politically right or correct or, you know, wanting to get everything right. And this is what Martha was doing. And rightfully so. This was God, her house. God was at her house. Now, I ain't nobody on his level. Nobody ain't on God level. I ain't on God level. Ain't no president. Ain't no commissioner. Ain't none of us. No elder, no deacon. Ain't none of y'all on his level. Ain't none of us on his level. But Martha didn't know altogether who he was at that time, but he was her Lord. He was a mentor. He was her minister that came. He was a friend of this family. And we don't know in the Bible why he was such friends of her and her sister and her brother. We don't know. But he had an affinity with this family. And so she's moving about and she's trying to do this and she's trying to do that and she's trying to make everything right. But Martha was coming about much serving and came to Jesus, and she said, don't you care? See, this is what sometimes God people say to God. Don't you care? Don't you care? Now she's asking him a question. Don't you care? And before he could even answer the question, she's telling him how to do it. Bid her to come help me. Bid Mary to come help me. And sometimes people get mad at God because they don't get help from the people that they want help from. But see, God is never, he will never give anybody his place. He will disappoint us every time because God will look to man. He will, yes, he'll use us. He'll use us to help one another. But if we're looking to one another to confirm us, to help us in the way that we need help, Martha, all she wanted Mary to get up from sitting at the feet of Jesus to help her cook some fish. To cook some fish. To look around in the house and see if the house was clean or not. Martha was experiencing an anxiety attack. She was having an anxiety attack. Care, this word care, is an uneasy, fearful feeling about our future outcome. Care brings the connotation of I'm uncertain, it's uneasy, I'm fearful, I'm feeling really uneasy about my future outcome. That's a panic attack. A panic attack is when we allow worry, and we're going to get to worry, but worry and the cares and the uneasy feeling and the things that's going around us, it attacks us. Our mind attacks us. Attacks our mind, attacks our body, attacks us. And we have a panic attack. I've had panic attacks. So I know what a panic attack can do. And first thing I do, I call on the name of Jesus. Then I call Elder Faye. Help me, Elder Faye. And we go to the Lord in prayer. And he helps me. But I've had panic attacks a couple times in my life. And it's because you think the outcome. You think you're having a heart attack. You think you're having a stroke. If it's physical. And you having the first thing happened was so-and-so, this happened to so-and-so. this happened to Aunt so-and-so, and when that happened to Aunt so-and-so, this is what happened. When you have a panic attack, you begin to have an uneasy feeling. You begin to think about what happened to somebody else instead of saying, God, that might have happened to somebody else. But I'm calling for your help, Lord. I need your help. Help wanted, Lord. Help wanted. I need some help right now to calm my mind, calm my soul down right now. And so the axe head anointing, you know, when you know that no matter if the paramedics get there on time or not, see, this is how far we got to go. In our real confidence and trust in God, is even if the paramedics don't get here on time, absent from the body, I'm present with the Lord. I'm going to keep my faith in him. And that's not always easy, people of God. That's not always easy. You can read about it. You can study about it. You can preach about it. But to live it is a whole totally different thing. So the axe head anointing message is for us to live it, not just preach it, not just quote it, not just talk about it, but to be able to live it and to see results as a result of it. Because in those times when I have had those panic attacks and when I calmed down and realized that was just I was having a panic attack, I begin to praise God first, but then you feel bad about the fact that your trust was not in God the way it should have been at that time. We do what we're supposed to do. Do what you have to do, but we got to consciously keep in the forefront of our mind that God is my source. The Holy Spirit is a present help in a time of need. You know, if you don't have, that's why the word of God is so important. Because if you don't have nothing in you, you can't get nothing out you. When the time comes, when the trouble comes, if there's nothing in you, you can't have nothing to draw from. But if the word of God is in you, you can pull it up. You can pull it up as an everlasting well. You can pull upon the well of God's salvation. You can pull upon the scriptures and say, the Bible says that with Jesus' stripes, I am healed, Lord. Father, you were your son, Jesus Christ, died on the cross for me. He was wounded for my transgressions. He was bruised for my iniquity. And the chastisement of my peace, your peace, and my peace was upon me, him. And with his stripes, I am healed. I am healed. I'm the heel where the devil is trying to make sick. Or you might not have enough money. And the bills is like this, and the finances is like this. You speak into those bills. You speak into those times. I'm getting a little ahead of myself, but I was talking to Pastor Allison Tedder last week, and she told me a testimony that I had not heard in a while. I had never heard it. And we were just talking, we was iron sharpening iron. We was talking about the goodness of the Lord and all that he had done for us over the years. And we worked together in the ministry, and who would have thought that a year from one another, we would both be widows. I think they call women widowers or widows. Widows, we are widows, little widow, I'm the little widow. And we would be pastor in the church. Who would ever thought that? And we were just talking about the goodness of God and how he has kept us over these couple years. And she began to tell me about a testimony. And I was telling her about what I was ministering on, axe head anointing. And she said, you know, she said, we always been taught, prophesy to the wind. Speak to your lack. Speak to it. And call those things that be not as though they were. And she said, at one time, I didn't have that much food. And she said, and I know that we was taught, you know, we supposed to have, we shouldn't be without. She said, and I was giving my tithes and I was doing everything I was supposed to do, but I didn't have enough food. She said, I had food, but not enough. She said, I opened up those cabinets. She said, I opened up my refrigerator. She said, and I began to speak to that refrigerator. She said, I say, food? You be in these cabinets. Food, I have more than enough food. I have enough food not only for my family, but I have enough food for other people that will come across my pathway. And she said, that's been all these years ago. She said, I'm passing out food. I'm giving out food. I'm giving out thousands of pounds of food every week. She said, I had so much food last week. I went down to a school and I adopted a school and I told them, I'll furnish your food. She said, that was because y'all taught us to prophesy to your lack. Prophesy to when things are not going your way. Call those things that be not as though they were. And so when we talk about the Martha, the spirit of care, there's always care. There's always something that we can say that we're dealing with something. There's always a care. There's always something that can cause you to be uneasy, have a fearful feeling. But see, when we are carrying and walking in the axe head anointing, then we harness it. We stop it in its track. We stop it before it even get a hold to the feeling. On the onset, we say, no, I'm not going to allow this. I'm not going to allow this to overtake me. And so Martha, because we never see where Martha really sat down at the feet of Jesus. We never see where she sat down. Because some unbelieving believers, they don't believe that the word of God is what the word of God is. They don't believe that praising him and worshiping him. Because sitting at Jesus' feet is a form of worship. It's a form of worship. Is a stance of saying, I have to call for you for my help. I don't know where it's going to come from. I don't know which way it's going to come. See, even in this situation with this virus, I don't know what to do. I don't. But I know who knows what to do. I know who knows what to do. And so therefore, I just keep following him. I keep stretching it out. I keep stretching it out. You know, I get up in the morning. I think this going to be the day that everything going to be flattened. It ain't. Stretch it on out. I keep stretching it out. But see, Martha, she wanted God, that was Jesus, that was their God, to help her. And her eyes was on somebody else. See, our eyes can't be on no one. When we're looking for help, You can't say, I need help. Help wanted. And you're looking at your mama. You're looking at your daddy. You're looking at your aunt. You're looking at your uncle. No, if you need help, you have to ask God, help, Lord. I need help. I need help. And when he comes to give you the help and he tells you what he's going to do, sometimes your help might be losing your house. Sometimes your help might be losing that car. Losing that whatever it is, losing that business that you can't afford. Sometimes your help might come in a way that you don't want that help to come. So Martha, her thing was, no, I need help. But Philippians chapter 4, verse 6 says, be careful for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be known unto who? God. Unto God. Unto God. Now, Luke chapter 10, verse 39 says, and she had a sister called Mary, which also, after she got done serving, after she got done doing all that, she sat at the feet of Jesus and heard the word. Now, this word, sitting at the feet of Jesus, means that I'm at peace. I'm at peace. I've had texts. I've had people to text me. I've had people call me. I've had people to try to tell me how we come back to do. I finally told them, I said, don't tell me nothing. I said, I don't need your advice. I don't want you to tell me how to do it. Let me let the Lord do it, because I'm sitting at the feet of Jesus. I'm sitting at the feet of Jesus. And when we sit at the feet of Jesus, then we have a contentment. We have a contentment, a restful, peaceful state of mind, undisturbed by outward circumstances or situations. That's contentment. Let me say it again. And I know we've heard this over and over and over in the Christian house of prayer. But I tell you what, the messages that we have heard over all these years has prepared us for this day. It has prepared us for this day. Contentment is a restful, peaceful state of mind, undisturbed by outward circumstances or situations. When it says that Mary sat, this word sat means to park, to relax, to hunker down, to settle down, to give rest to your feet. Give rest to your feet. Because see, if you don't give rest to your feet walking, trying, I'm pacing the floor. What to do? What to do? What to do, Lord? What to do, Lord? No, he said, if you take care of my house, I'm going to take care of your house. And so the people in this church, you've been taking care of this house, and God going to continue to take care of your house. So to sit means to park, to park, to relax. It's a little hot in here. Y'all hot? To relax. I am. To relax, to park, to relax, to hunker down. Hunker down. That's the Holy Ghost. That's the Holy Ghost. To hunker down. To rest on your feet. Just sit down. Just enjoy the ride. Ride it out. Just ride it out. Ride it out. That's we're going to ride it out. No matter what's happening on the outside, it cannot disturb the inside when you have contentment. No matter what's going on the outside, come on, let's say it with me. No matter what's going on the outside, on the inside, I will not be disturbed. My peace will not be disturbed. If you're sitting at the feet of Jesus, then you're content. If you're not sitting at the feet of Jesus, you're having a panic attack. You're worrying. I opened it up for prayer. I opened the church up and Christian House of Prayer, this is our broadcast. This broadcast is here for me to talk to y'all. I opened up for prayer. That was the first opening of the church. Prayer. So when I hear people say, well, when is the church going to open? The church been open for prayer. But you ain't here. Prayer. We got all outside to walk around. We got so much distancing. Prayer. So see, people vote with their feet. So that's the reason why I have to have a contentment in him. Not in myself. Not in nobody else, but in me. Because no matter who comes for prayer, no matter who comes for whatever, God is still in control. He's going to do what he said he's going to do. And I know that God ain't going to close up no church forever. I know he not. But the church is in us. We are the church. But when we sit at the feet of Jesus at home, see, even when we have service on Sunday, when we sit at the feet of Jesus, when you sit at the feet of Jesus and we have designated this time to come and hear what the Lord is saying to us, the church, we get up, we get ready. We don't have to put our clothes on, but sit down. Get your Bible. Don't try to cook breakfast while I'm preaching. You sit down. You listen to the word of God. Open up your Bible. Get your pencil. Get your notepad. Sit down. What is the Lord saying? The Lord is saying, help wanted. Do you want his help? Because he's a very present help in a time of need. You sit down. You tell kids, sit down. It's church time. It's time for service. We might not be in the building, but God is in us, and we're here for service. Sit down. Get up. You're not going to sleep on God. Get up. Sit down. We're going to hear the word of God. See, this is where our help come from. Sitting at the feet of Jesus. Sitting at the feet of Jesus means that I'm casting all my cares upon him. Because he cares for us and he wants us to. Sitting at the feet of Jesus means that I have a restful. I have a peaceful. And I know that y'all been hearing me talk a lot about the peace. I know y'all been hearing me talk a lot about that. because that is so valuable. Having that peace that passed all understanding is so valuable, because when you have that contentment, when you have that peace, when you have that restful, peaceful state of mind, then no matter what's going on, no matter what's going on, I do believe in my heart. I truly believe that. I believe that everybody is doing the best they can do. Everybody, including our politicians, I believe they're doing the best they can do. But see, I know who can do the best, and he knows the best. He's Alpha. He's the Ancient of Days. And so he supersedes our own mind. He supersedes anything. They're saying that they're going to give another wave of money. Thank God for the money. Thank God for all of that. But only the Lord can stretch what we get. Only the Lord can take the little bit and make it enough, more than enough. Only God can do that. Only God can do that. And give us wisdom through the Holy Spirit. So when we get whatever we get, we're able to use it in a proper way. Amen. When we sit at the feet of Jesus, he teaches us and he lets us know what we are to do. Amen. Amen. Let's give God a praise. 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 You know, when Peter was walking on the water, in Matthew chapter 14, verse 30, it says, "But when he saw that the wind was boisterous, he was afraid." He was afraid. That care came in. He began to worry. And beginning to sink, he cried and said, "Lord, save me." That's like help wanted. "Lord, help me. Help me, Lord. Lord, help me." And did he not help him? Did he not help him? He helped him. He helped him. He's a very present help. Very present help in a time of need. Now worry, I want to go back a little bit. Worry is it demobilizes us. It causes us to doubt God. It causes us to feel like, "Well, God, I know that you're you hear my prayers, but you're not doing nothing. I don't see nothing happening." That's worry. Worry is, I know what you said, but I don't see nothing happening. No, something is happening when it seems like it's nothing happening. People, I really want you. I'm serious. I'm serious about this. Because God is reducing his armies. And then he's going to build it back up again. But he's looking for the Gideon soldiers. He's looking for those that are true soldiers, are true soldiers in the army of the Lord. He's looking for those that if you're afraid, it's almost like the Holy Ghost saying, "Go home." He's saying if you're too occupied, it's almost like he's saying, "Go home." If you don't understand the season and the time, you got to go home, because you're going to mess up the fight. You're going to mess up the plan of God. And so what my endeavor is those that have fallen behind, those that have slacked up, those that have lost your grip, those that have lost your zeal, your zeal for the Lord. See, everything that been shut up, well, we got to believe for everything. So that we can get the fire of God back in our lives. The fire of God. I'm talking about, though, I want to see the move of God moving in a way like it's never moved before. I want to see the blinded eyes to be open. I want to see Uncle Bobo and so-and-so, who they thought would never be saved. See, because God usually uses the ones that don't serve God. He usually uses the ones that seem like to be the black sheep of the family. Those are usually the leaders in the ministry. And the devil will try to hold them back. And so this axe head anointing is just not a message. It's just not something that we hear that sounds good. Is a force behind it. It's like I'm taking back what the devil has tried to steal from us, even through this virus. See, fellowship with one another. He's trying to steal it from us. But see, we still gonna pray for one another. We're gonna call one another, check on one another. Amen. We're gonna do the opposite of what he thought the forecast was gonna be. See, the army has to be reduced before it can explode. Because we gotta get out the unbelieving believers and bring in the believing believers. Those that can believe him in spirit and in truth. Amen. We're gonna pick up the weak and we're gonna pull them along, but sooner or later they're gonna have to get strength in them feet. They're gonna have to get strength because we're gonna need strength to do what we gotta do in the days ahead. We're talking about virtual choirs. Virtual. Think about it. If the people in the choir are sitting next to each other and they singing, droppings coming out their mouth, they can't sing with the mask on. We need help. And yes, I want it. I want the help from the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let's give God a praise. Let's give God a praise. We need help. We need help with our families. We need help with our jobs. We need help with our health. We need help with everything. In Romans chapter 8, verse 26, it says, likewise, the Spirit also helpeth our infirmities, for we know not what we should pray for as we ought. But the Spirit itself maketh intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. Now this word helpeth is the work. We work together with the Holy Spirit to get the job done. To get the job done, people of God. The Holy Spirit need us to work together with him. Sunate lamboni is a compound word. Sunate lamboni. The Holy Spirit cannot do it on its own. He need us to help him get the job done. Su means together with. Anti is that which is opposite or against. And lamboni is to take hold to. So it means that the Spirit of God takes hold through the Holy Spirit together with us to help us. The Holy Spirit help us. But we have to help him. Sunate lamboni. He can't do it by himself. So he take us together with him to help him get the job done in the earth realm. So we need the help of the Holy Ghost. We need his help. See, God has already prepared. He's already prepared a plan, church. Christian House of Prayer, God has already, he already have a plan. We don't know it yet, but he already have a plan. And we must keep that magnetism of optimism. We have to keep it going. Because we know, Lord, that we know that the Holy Spirit, he's moving. He's progressively moving. He's moving. We have to keep our magnetism of optimism. We've been taught that. And magnetism, because it draws. Our faith draws what we want. If we negativity, if you got negativity, death and life is in the power of your words. We have to be very careful about our words. Because that magnetism of optimism, which is the yoke destroying, burden removing, power of God that's released through the Holy Spirit, can only be released through us. The Holy Spirit, if I came up here this morning and we say, the Holy Spirit is going to minister today. And ain't nobody up here. The Holy Spirit is going to minister today. Well, I got to get in there with the Holy Spirit in order to minister. He need us to work together with him in order to get the job done. Now, he's going to choose the way. He's going to confirm the way. And he's going to clear the way for us to come back here. God gave me that message years ago. Choose the way. Confirm the way. Clear the way. He's going to do exactly what he said he was going to do years ago. This was for this day. Years ago, the messages that's been preached on contentment and confidence and how that we are instrument-rated Christians. All of those messages was preached back then for today. Amen? And we are a church that have been founded on faith in God. This is a church that has been founded on, we don't have no problems. All we need is faith in God. Amen. And ain't nothing changed. Nothing has changed. Our situation has changed, but our message has not changed. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. And so we have to know today that God has sent the third person of the Godhead. Jesus asked for Alos Parakletos to come on back here. Equal, but different in function. And his job is to carry on the work that Jesus has already done. And it's not going to be finished until Jesus come back for us, a church. And when he come back, the Bible says, will he still find us in faith when he come? And I'm saying, with an optimism of optimism, I'm saying it right now that he will. He will find a church that is still praising him. He will find a church that's still glorifying him. He will find a church that know where their help come from, because we know that our help coming from the Lord. Amen. And when we seem to get feeble, when it seems like we can't go on, then we will draw nigh. We will draw closer. We won't just sit at his feet. We'll get up in his bosom if we have to. We'll lay upon him because he's the breasted one. We'll know that our help coming from him. We'll say, Lord, I need your nourishment. I need a little milk coming from you, Lord. I got to get closer than I was before. We cannot give up. We cannot back up. We cannot slack up. We got to go forward. We got to move forward. And we need the help of the Holy Ghost to do it. And so he's just not a goosebump. He's just not something that makes the atmosphere. He can change your atmosphere. But it's already changed for the better. It's already changed for the better. The Lord has showed me. And this is going to be the greatest revival. And I'm talking about in our houses right now, in the homes. People are praying like they never prayed before. The families are coming back together. You know, think about how our family, one person's eating in one room, the other person eating in the other room, got TV trays all in front of you and everything. We're getting back to the way that it was supposed to be. Families are getting back to the table and talking about how their day was. People are starting to listen to one another and put down the doggone computer. Put down the phone. Put down the phone and sit at the feet of Jesus. Get at the feet of Jesus. Because it's at his feet is where we get our peace. Our peace. Our contentment. Our future is bright. Because we see it's already written in the script. It's nothing that can happen that's going to change what is written. What is written cannot be changed. So the devil can come whatever he want to come with. But it's written in the script. We win. We win. We win. We win. Don't patty cake if you're going to praise him. Go ahead and praise him. Go ahead and praise him. Go ahead and praise him. Because he's worthy of our praises. He's worthy of our praises. He's worthy. He's worthy. He's worthy. He's worthy. Hallelujah. Listen. There might be one. There might be two. There might be 20. There might be 100 people out there that's ready to be birthed into the family of God, to the kingdom, to the kingdom of God. And if you've never met Jesus, if you've never been introduced to him, I want you to know that Jesus is Lord. He came to die for the sins of the world. And he was successful. He died on an old rugged cross called Calvary. Jesus, the Son of God. This is not fairy tale. Don't listen. Don't listen to the atheists. Don't listen to people that will tell you that God is not real, that he's like Santa Claus. He's like the tooth fairy. He's like Peter Pan. No, heaven is not never, never land, but heaven will last forever. And this life is short, very short. And each year as we go by, it becomes shorter and shorter. But guess what, friend? Guess what, mother? Guess what, dad? Guess what, young man, young woman? Death don't have no age on it. Death don't have no age on it. Don't think that I'm going to wait till I'm old. You might not get that opportunity. Now is the day of salvation. And God can do so much with your life. Even young people, as you're graduating from college and graduating from high school, God can use your life now. You don't have to wait till you're 40, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, 80. God can use you right now. And if you are 50, 60, 70, it's not too late. Because every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Don't let nobody fool you. When you look out at the sky, who put the sky up there? Who made the stars? Who made the green grass green? Who made the sky blue? There have to be a God. Who can make us? Who can have a baby growing inside of a mother's womb for 9 months and come out as a human being? Who can do that but God? And he sent his only begotten son, Jesus, that we can have life with him eternally. And so today, if you do not know Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, I want you to do something with me this morning. I want you to take your hands, get up off the chair, and make your way over. If you have your phone, your smartphone, whatever you are, TV, I don't know where you're looking at me on. But take your hands and put your hand right on that telephone. Put your hands right on that TV screen. Put your hands right there. And I want you to repeat this after me. I am a sinner in need of a Savior. I believe that Jesus Christ is your Son. I believe that Jesus, your Son, died for my sins. I believe you raised him from the dead for me. Right now, Lord, I want to trust you as my Savior and Lord. I want to follow you as my Lord and guide me in my life so I can do your will. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Now that simple prayer, it starts with a confession. If I believe that Jesus is the Son of God, I believe it in my heart and I confess it with my mouth. You believed it with your heart. And that's why you confessed it with your mouth. And because you confessed it with your mouth, then you have made a declaration to God the Father that I want Jesus to be my Savior and my Lord. And today, if you've done that for the very first time, when this broadcast is over, I want you to call. We have trained ministers and counselors that want to talk to you and pray with you so that you can hear someone's voice personal to minister to you personally. And I believe there's at least 20, 25, 30, 40, 50. There's thousands of people, over 9,000 people that's watching this broadcast right now. And I know that there's people that have gotten saved today. So let us know so we can rejoice with you. Don't say I don't have to call. No, call. We want to know. We want to give God the praise and the glory. And we want to rejoice with you because you are now in the family of God. And we thank God that we will rule and reign together forever. Amen. And if you need prayer, you don't have contentment. You're full of care. You're full of worry like we talked about today. We have counselors that would minister to you. I pray that you receive the word of God. And I pray that you know that you don't have to have, you don't have to have that care. You don't have to be worried. You don't have to have that uneasy feeling of your outcome, of your future. You don't have to have that. But you have to get at the feet of Jesus. And you start off by, if you don't know how to pray, or if you want somebody to pray with you, you're not alone. We have counselors. We have ministers that's here for you to serve you in that capacity. Amen. I'm excited about our future. I'm excited about the days ahead. I'm praying that all the those that are in authority that's over us, that they would have the mind of Christ and they would be able to handle every situation as they ought to. I'm praying that they do what they're supposed to do, but I'm relying on God to do what only He could do, and that He will use the Holy Spirit to make sure that He will let us know what the plan is when the time comes. So Christian House of Prayer, Covenant Connection International, and all those of you that are watching today, know that you don't have no problems. All you need is faith in God. God bless you, and we'll see you. I want to say one other thing. Next week is going to be very special. Every week is special, but this is going to be special because this is a time that we set out to have our Spring Praise and Worship program. We have it twice a year, and next Sunday will be our praise and worship. Praise, just bring your praise on. Get your tambourine out, and we're going to get our praise on. Ain't no party like a Holy Ghost party, and a Holy Ghost party don't stop. So get your praise on, and we'll see you on next week, and we're going to praise Him. God bless you. Everything's going our way in the Lord because we're going in the way of the Lord. God bless you, and I'll see you next week. Amen.
Attacking every day, but I'm watching while I